Okay, let's start with Judea, who was also there, not in Cleveland, but in Bnei Brak, nachon?
Yes, I had the same experience as described by Amos Oz. I was 11 years old in my little town of Bnei Brak, which is about 7.5 miles from Tel Aviv. And I had this strange feeling of holiness that one can get only in Yom Kippur. And the reason I had this feeling of holiness is only in Yom Kippur you find a unity of the heart among people that quarrel all year long. And in my little town, people quarrel all day long. The shoemaker fought with the fish seller, and the tailor fought with the grocery man on every customer, on every little bit of grush or lira. And that day, exactly like in Yom Kippur, you saw them together. The grocery man and the shoe sellers hugging each other, standing in front of one event that unites them like the power that united me on that evening and connected my spine to the spine of every Jew that ever lived. And my father grabbed me on that day and said, "You don't understand." I said, "Yes, I do." "No, you don't understand." I said, "What do I have to understand?" I said, "It's all over. Don't you get it? It's all over. What is over?" And I must tell you that I had a wall between me and my father until that day. The wall was that he came from Poland, and he went there to Polish school, and he knew what it means to be a Jew in a Polish school. I didn't. So I asked him, "What's going on? What is the big thing?" And at that point, the wall fell down. He told me that it's over, namely the Gola is over, the diaspora is over, and all this legend that you read in your books now, from Khmelnytsky to the Inquisition and to Majdanek and Auschwitz, it's all over, don't you get it? And I told him, "Yes, of course, it's over." And at that moment, I saw that his eyes were also meeting with my eyes, and he got the divine touch of normalcy at that point. And we reached a common ground at that point. So I vividly remember that day, and I came here at the request of Steve to commemorate a day that is pivotal in our history. And I came here to give thanks to 33 countries. And I think the Jewish communities in every large city in the US should commemorate the day at the Jewish Thanksgiving Day and give thanks to 33 countries that voted their conscience at the time of our need. And it changed our sense of dignity and pride and self-image that every Jewish soul has enjoyed since. So we are here. No, the Federation did not hang 33 flags from its building. It should have had. We are here to thank heroes of November 29. These were ordinary Jews that acted in any way that they could to bring about this vote. We should thank Eddie Jacobson, who was President Harry Truman's friend and former business partner. And he risked their friendship, and he wrote to Truman on October 3rd, 1947, "Harry, my people need your help. And I'm appealing to you to help them. And he did need his help because the State Department, like today, were dragging their feet. And Chaim Weizmann asked for one more audience with Truman, and Jacobson arranged for that audience. And we are here to give thanks to Albert Einstein, who pleaded, albeit unsuccessfully, with Nehru, then the Prime Minister of India, to vote for the August scale of justice. And we need to thank Cardinal Spellman, the head of the Catholic Church in New York City, who days before the vote used his personal influence in Latin American countries and urged them to vote yes. And we must thank many ordinary yet courageous people from Peru to the Philippines who understood the collective responsibility that history bestowed upon them in 1947 and used everything in their power, from personal pleading to arm twisting, to influence their government to vote yes. Let us thank also 33 ethnic communities in Los Angeles and remind them that we Jews do not forget friends who stood with us on the side of justice. We give thanks and ask for nothing in return. And while we thank history for its miracles, let us remind ourselves and others of few basic facts. Let us remind the world that Israel is there by historical right, not by force and not by favor. And let us remind the UN what kind of institution it once was. And let us do it this month, when by Orwellian mockery, the UN Human Rights Council elected Congo and Qatar and Pakistan to join the anointed guardian of mankind. So let us refresh our memories with all the arguments, pro and con, regarding the idea of a Jewish state, arguments that our enemies have mastered to perfection and we have naively assumed to be no longer necessary to the point of delinquent forgetfulness. And let us express ceremonially what we have tacitly understood for quite some time, that Israel constitutes the only uniting force among world Jewry today, without which collective Jewish identity would cease to exist. And I would like to emphasize this point because it is not clear to many in our communities that you don't build a nation on bagels, not even on Holocaust memories, not only on Holocaust memories combined with Tikkun Olam. To build a nation, you need an ethos, historical ethos of rebirth, of triumph and rebirth. And this is what Israel contributes to our consciousness here. So I would like to say that twice to all these nice Jewish Tikkun Olam champions who are competing on a seat on the bandwagon of Linda Sarsour. They will end up in the dustbin of history without the recognition that Israel today is the uniting force. Israel today offers the most meaningful content for children education. I will finalize. We must finalize by reminding the Arab world that the UN voted for two states, not only for one state, as their spoken pretend to claim, and that the option of Palestinian statehood is still on the table, waiting for them to eternalize the meaning of the word coexistence and to learn to utter the words equally legitimate and equally indigenous.